everybody. I'm your friend Matt. Even if we haven't met, we're friends already anyway. So you're going to have to come up to me and actually fulfill that a little bit later. I wrote a 500-plus page book because I'm a masochist called Laravel Up and Running. I run a company called Titan, have a couple podcasts. Check it out later. But I am here to talk to you about Laravel New and what to do after you run Laravel New. So when I give talks, I have two primary criteria for my talks. The number one is it's a practical felt need. People actually care about this thing. They want to make sure that like this is something that is going to impact their ability to do their job or satisfy their life cravings or whatever afterwards. And second of all, something I have practical experience in. I try not to give a lot of talks based on theory or things that I've just learned just to give the talk. I do it sometimes, but usually I want to say, hey, I've done this 1,000 times. Here, hopefully you don't have to do 1,000 times to have this knowledge that I have to share. In this particular one, what I'm primarily looking at is what does it look like when you have learned the thing? You've watched all the videos, you've watched the tutorials, and then you sit down to do the thing, and you're like, I don't actually know where to start here, you know? It is a very, very common thing we hear from a lot of people where they're just like, I really thought I knew it, and then I sat down in front of the terminal and I just went, now what? What are we gonna do here? We hear these things from our clients and from our friends all the time. I've watched a million videos, or I've been maintaining an app for the last 10 years, but it's been so long since I've started one fresh, or maybe it's something like, I wanna make sure I get it just right at the beginning because I know those first steps are gonna carry on for the next 10 years, and I really wanna not screw it up right now. There's also this one, which it's small here, so I have to look up here. If possible, add one here that makes the audience laugh and warms them up. This is the first talk after all. You know, it could be funny to just leave this here. You've got to really get a sense of the audience's sense of humor. If you just left this here and didn't actually fill out with a real item, maybe it's even funnier. The longer you make it, also add something about super Australian stuff like Bluey or Death Spiders or Fairy Bread. Thank you. We're going to keep going there for a second, though. Okay, so this is the Telegram channel for the Laracon AU speakers back in July. And I said, my wife and I just watched an Ann Reardon video in where she and her family talked about something called fairy bread. We tried it, and it was not great. I'm sorry. Is this something all of y'all have any nostalgia for? And Michael was not having it. But we very quickly after realized that we didn't have the right details. We tried honey wheat bread. Do not do that with your fairy bread. We had margarine because Ann Reardon told us to. Apparently not. And we had rainbow sprinkles, which are not the same as hundreds of thousands, which we had to learn. So, I have with me here fairy bread made by Kath, and I've never tasted the real thing before. This is my first time since that horrible moment back in July, and I'm doing it live on stage, and dear God, I hope I like it, because otherwise you all will hate me, and he's going to pull me off stage with a hook. So, here we go. Oh, it's also been sitting for the last hour. Oh, that's brilliant. That's so much better. Thank you for this experience. You don't know how nervous I was that I wasn't going to like it. Okay, you've done a good thing there. So in this talk, back to the actual talk, I'm going to mention, and you've also probably heard people in our community mention this word idiomatic. Idiomatic Laravel, idiomatic JavaScript, or whatever. But in order to talk about that, we need to actually say, like, what does idiomatic mean? And you're familiar with the word idiom, which is sort of like a turn of phrase, but there's actually a different concept of idiomatic. And it's basically this idea of kind of like the way people in a particular area or class or whatever talk. And that's related to a concept of idiom, which is sort of like the way they talk. So idiomatic really means how we particularly or we uniquely do a thing. So when you think about idiomatic Laravel or idiomatic JavaScript or whatever else, you start thinking, oh, how we particularly write Laravel. And you'd think it's super clear when all you have to do is just look at, for example, the docs or look at a Laracast. But there's so much more about how you do the thing that's contextual to stuff that may not fit into the docs or it may not fit into a Laracast. We just generate kind of a community understanding of how we do things over time of doing the thing. And the good news is at Titan, we are a consultancy. We've been doing this for 13 years, I think. So we've created and inherited hundreds and thousands of code bases in Laravel. We've also watched lots of Laracasts and made books and stuff like that. So we have a lot of ideas about what the Laravel community thinks idiomatic Laravel is and sort of some of our own opinions about this at all as well. And I will say, I am the first person in the world to say it depends. I don't think there's the absolute right way to do very, very, very many things. But there are a few things that if you just say, we don't have to make this decision every time, we don't have to bike shed every time, let's get this done so we can then bike shed on the fun things that are unique to this project, you get a lot further. And so that's what this talk is about, is what can we just say, let's just do these 99% of the time, 98% of the time. If you hate one of them, that's totally fine. But it's for those who aren't sure, I'm trying to give you something to start with so you don't have to waste your time on this. Three primary sections we're gonna work in here. Packages and code that you wanna put in every single app. Ops and services, like SaaSes and stuff you want to use in every single app, and then processes and practices that you want to use to get your projects up and running. So I started with building some trust by having fairy bread and you liked it, and then I immediately lied to you because we're actually going to talk a little bit about what to do before Laravel New, even though that's not the title. It's tiny story time for you. In the early days of Laravel, we had the Laravel installer, and all it really did was just clone down the project using Composer Create Project, and that was it. And I was like, that's cool, but at this time, I'm creating a new app at least every week between tutorials and clients and my own personal side projects and stuff like that. And I had to do the same steps every single time. So I built this project called Lambo. It's originally built in lots and lots and lots and lots and lots of bash, and it was exhausting to maintain. So we rewrote the thing live in Laravel 0, which is really cool, but it's even more code and more complexity. And I was not the person maintaining the Laravel installer, so every time they made a change, I had to make a change. It was a cool idea, but a lot of work. But thankfully, the Laravel installer does all that. You don't need Lambo anymore, because the Laravel installer brings in all these other really cool things at this point, where you can pick Breeze and Jetstream, pest versus PHP unit. It's going to change your .env settings. It's going to migrate your database. All that stuff, you have to either do it manually or use Lambo to do in the past. Laravel installer does it for you. So while some people write Composer Create Project, don't use it, use Laravel installer. It's going to save you a ton of time. I also would recommend that you use one of the Laravel preferred hosting environments. Use Valet and use something like Takeout for your services. If you're willing to drop a dollar or two, Herd makes it so easy to just install everything with a GUI and then it'll manage all your interdependencies for you. Or if you like Docker, use something like Sail or your own Docker files. I also want to make sure that when you have your local hosting environment set up, make sure that you have a way to push your local environment up through ngrok or expose or Cloudflare tunnel or something like that. We'll talk about it more later in this talk, but even outside of this talk, it's super valuable to be able to just share something to your cell phone or to a coworker before you push it up to a staging site. And finally, please, 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 you're saving yourself or the team or someone who takes over this project for you later. Commit, or so much pain, by committing to do something the Laravel way or the idiomatic Laravel way. And what I mean by that is if you see, oh, well, there's a Laravel tool for this, but I'm smarter and I'm better and I know what I'm doing and I'm going to write my own thing, you are setting yourself up for pain later, whether it's because you're not smarter and so your thing's going to cause security holes down the road, or if there's a new feature that comes down the road later, that feature is going to work with Laravel's version, but it's not going to work with your version. So suddenly your team adopting that new feature that you've not been able to predict for today, Laravel's going to take the responsibility for their internal tooling matching up with that new feature. But now you and your team have to do the work to make sure that your manual auth or your manual whatever else or your manual multi-process works with it. So just stick with the Laravel way. It's going to save you a ton of pain. Okay, remember, three big sections. We're going to start with packages and code. So the first thing I would say is your magnum opus should not be where you put braces. It shouldn't be single quotes versus double quotes. It shouldn't be because you like the brace at the beginning of the function to be on the new line or not the new line. That should be something that's defined, and we all do it the same way, and then we never think about it ever again. Again, bike shedding can be fun, but it's not productive. And so code style is not one of the ways I recommend that you spend your time and your energy. Lots of different tools, but if you don't have one, Duster's a tool we have at Titan that brings in PHP CS Fixer, Pint, and TLint. Just throws them all with a generic configuration. It starts with Titan's configuration. If you don't like it, you can also set it to Laravel's, or you can set your own. And from day one, you have local command line things you can run to lint and format your code. You can also set it up in your build tooling. Just do it. Don't think about it anymore. Do it at the beginning of every project, and then never think about code style ever again. If you want to do it in the front end, you probably already know that Prettier is the main one people use for JavaScript. But you can also set Prettier up to lint all your blade, make sure your Tailwind class order is all the same. Again, you should not spend any time thinking about that. Your senior developers should not be reviewing your junior's code style. It should be automatically applied, then move on to things that actually matter. You should install a debug tool. There's a couple debug bars, the easiest one to get started with, and makes it super easy that if you're doing any kind of performance or load testing, you're like, why is this page taking really long to load? You tap a little button, it shows you all the SQL queries are running, or all the views that have loaded, or the controller methods, or anything like that they're running. It's just super easy to kind of process what's going on, and when you're not thinking about it, it just kind of disappears out of the way. Looks really nice, super convenient. You should have set up a bug tracker. It's the type of thing where once you need it, you wish you'd done it originally, so just do it now. We'll talk about which bug tracker to use later in the ops and services section, but just install one of them, please. And this is kind of what it looks like, and again, we'll talk about it later, but it sends your exceptions up to some centralized service so you can kind of all share that exception and understand it together. It's even more valuable once you have a staging site set up. You should install one of Laravel's auth kit. Don't write auth yourself. Dear God, please don't write auth yourself. Please, dear God, don't do that. So there's a lot of people who ask the question of which you should use. Taylor and I have talked about it in the podcast a whole bunch. But you may be surprised to hear that while this is the checklist, which seems to make it pretty clear which one you should use, I actually think the vast majority of Laravel applications today should use Breeze. I know that's kind of wild, but the thing is, it is so simple. The files are in your code. You know exactly what's going on. It's super, super clear. And Jetstream, while it's very powerful and has a ton of great features, all the code is pulled through different vendor things, and it's a lot harder for you to process, to debug, and for newcomers to understand. So if you can get it done with Breeze, get it done with Breeze, even if you might have to steal some of the team code from Jetstream and write it yourself, it's worth it. And we've done it a lot of times, and we've been really grateful that we did it. Set up a great README. Whether or not you're open source project, you want new people into the company, new programmers who come in because they're contracting, consultants who come in, maybe you, 3 years down the road, because you haven't touched this code base for a while, to have a really easy experience of walking into this code base and saying, I know exactly how to clone it, I know how to set up my dependencies, I just remembered I have slides for this, and I know what it looks like to contribute. And this may be a little bit more specific to open source, but like, what are the steps I need to run to build this thing before I push it up? Do I build before or after I'm pushing? Am I supposed to run these tests? Am I supposed to run this command? Some of those things can be automated through Git hooks and stuff like that, but even do I need to set up Husky for my Git hooks is something that should be in the README. The README should take me from, I've never heard of this thing before, but I understand Laravel, to I am up and running and contributing with the shortest amount of time possible. Look at any of Titan's open source packages. Spotsy's got a lot of great ones, but most of Spotsy's are packages. At Titan, we have a few software as a services that are open source, and so you can take a look at what a decent SaaS or app kind of README can look like. And we also have robust factories and Cedars. So one of the things we have often at Titan is we take over a code base, and we haven't seen it forever, and we get something like this, a 200 megabyte or often a 2 gigabyte file that is a production dump of personally identifying information, full of everything, completely not legal or ethical and stuff like that. And they're like, oh, just make sure nobody who doesn't supposed to get it gets it. Or, oh, we've got this old head Bill who works out in the corner, and he's slowly going to work out a script that's going to remove all the personal identifying information, but it's going to take 3 months before he gets to it, so you just don't have any data for the first 3 months or something like that. We don't want that. Remember, somebody who's never seen this code base ever before should be able to enter and be useful within preferably hours. That is not hours of work. So what we want instead is to ensure that somebody can show up and run a command in code, and having just checked out in the code, that's it. They have a perfectly functional version of the application that gives them all the different instances or edge cases or whatever that they want to test. The easiest way to do this is to do it the way that the docs show you to do. Uh-oh, I'm not clicking. Oh, that's why. Sorry for whoever I just accidentally lasered. that's very fun, though. The docs are going to show you this wonderful way to do it, and if you can do it this way, do it this way. It's just going to be basically you're going to define all your individual models in factories, and then your seeders are just going to say, hey, give me 5 users, each of which have 20 blog posts, each of which have 15 comments on it. It's really beautiful and wonderful and robust. However, sometimes that's not specific enough for you. Your customers really need to see that one person's name in order to get it, or you need this really weird edge casey relationship set up, and you just can't do it with that. And a lot of people say, therefore, we're not going to set up seeders. No. You just set up more customized seeders. It's also completely acceptable to do it this way. And you set up the specific environment you need or the specific clients you need. You can define it in code. You can define it in a SQL file. But regardless, again, I should see a command that I need to run in your README. I should run it. And this should all be set up. And I should just be able to walk through the app and be in the environment I need to be to test it, to use it, to run through QA or whatever else. And this is our last item in packages and code. The number of times I've seen people put months and years of work into building an application or a website or whatever else, and everyone's so excited, and we've been doing the launch process for the last 3 weeks, and we finally get to it, and we put it up on LinkedIn and Twitter and Blue Sky, and oh my God, it's just a static link, and that's it. Because nobody thought to put the social preview in. There's no Twitter cards, there's no Open Graph or anything like that. And if you're not familiar with these, I should tell you this at the beginning. At the end of this talk, I'm gonna have a little QR code that you can scan that takes you to a GitHub gist with a whole bunch of links. So don't worry about if I reference something here, you'll see it in the links in the end. And one of the things we do there is a template, one of those links is a template of just what a basic Open Graph set of parameters look like. An Open Graph allows you to basically everything other than Twitter to define what this share looks like. And so the share might be like a text share like this. It might be more like an image share like this. But in this code, just in a few lines of meta, you can say, what is the title? What's the body? Does it have an image? How big is the image? What should it link to? What's the page name? What's the overall site name? There's so much you can customize. And if you just do it on day one, you can at least set up one basic one that runs for the whole site. Sometimes you might even contextualize it per page, like a blog post might get a different one. But again, just think about it at the beginning, because if you're scrambling right after you finally did your prod deploy, there's so many things get messed up or go wrong when you're trying to the last second prod deploy because you shared it with the president of the company, and the president's like, why is it not showing right in LinkedIn when I show it to all my CEO buddies or whatever? If you want to set that up, so first of all, remember, you have something like Valet or Herd, you have ngrok or Expose set up. So what you're doing is you're doing your local development, and you share it up to an ngrok URL or something like that, so it's out on the public internet. Throw it up on opengraph.xyz, and it's going to show you exactly what it's going to share on Facebook and LinkedIn and all these other social sites that take OpenGraph. Twitter is its own little thing, so deal with that if you want. But everybody else uses OpenGraph, and so just use this to check it out. OK, that's packages and code. Next thing is ops and services. So remember, ops and services is like software as a service that you set up. How are the different kind of pieces setting up? Not necessarily for your production app, but at least while you're in the development process. First one is, I know not everyone agrees with this, you should use GitHub. And if anybody here is not familiar with the concept of fungible, and we all kind of went through our whole NFT phase and everything like that, but fungible means you can exchange one for the other without really noticing a difference. So something that is fungible is sort of like a gas. I don't really care who's providing my gas. I just want it to be the cheapest possible gas for my car, right? So that is a fungible item, whereas coffee is not fungible. Starbucks versus some amazing Australian, you know, coffee place, these are not the same thing. Even they're both coffee, but they're not fungible in that they're not exactly the same thing. So Git hosting is something we often mistakenly think of as fungible. Look, I push my Git up and it pulls my Git down, right? It's just fungible. But it's not the same, and there's a lot of different things about make those different, and I could give a whole talk about this. But the simplest thing I would say is GitHub's user interface, the user experience affordances that they came up with, even when somebody else came along and tried to steal something like pull requests, they always do it worse. The amount of integrations they have with other applications, because GitHub is the go-to. That means when somebody builds a new cool tool, they're going to interact with GitHub before anything else. And also even just the meaningfulness for you as a developer knowing GitHub and how that affects your hireability. Funny story, autocorrect turned that into fireable for the first. And I was like, no, that's not the message we're trying to send here. Had to fix that one. But if you have any control or power over it at all, go for GitHub. The number one reason why people don't do GitHub is because they think that GitHub is very expensive, but it's not anymore. It's actually significantly cheaper to get started than it used to be. The number two reason is because they use some other tool, Jira, Confluence, or whatever, that is already connected to Bitbucket or GitLab. It's not worth it. If you have control, move to GitHub. Funny story, our next item is that you should set up continuous integration, and you will not be surprised about what CI server I tell you you should use. But those who aren't familiar, continuous integration means every single time you do certain things in your code, whether you push up a new commit, or you merge a pull request, or whatever else it ends up being, a certain script should run. And that script may do one of multiple things. It might build your front end, it might run some tests, it might lint your code or format and fix your code, and when those things run, they can return an either positive or a negative response, so like a failure or a success. And if the thing fails, it can stop the whole process. So for example, if you have your CI set up that every single time we push up a new commit or every time we merge a pull request or whatever, then it's going to run our tests, it's going to check our code, and it's going to maybe build some front-end stuff. If your tests fail, the whole process stops, everything turns red, and it said, I will not run your deployer, and I will not accept this merge or whatever until you fix those tests, until you fix this code or whatever. So you have so much power to kind of ensure that things are in a certain state before they go to production or before they get to merge to main or whatever else it ends up being. And we prefer, no surprise, GitHub Actions. There are a lot of dedicated platforms for continuous integration. And there's one called Chipper CI. If you're going to do one, it's a really great one because it's made by and for the Laravel community. However, with love to all those folks, GitHub Actions, we're already in GitHub. It's already connected to GitHub. And you're doing all your definition in the code. And we all probably have our various feelings around YAML. But it is a very helpful tool for us to be able to say, here's each of our scripts. Here's what they should run. You can even you can run your own scripts. Or you can pull from predefined scripts that people already run. So if you have a certain tool, you're like, I really want to run PHPCS. There might be a pre-built PHPCS GitHub action out there. So you don't have to write the code yourself. And it all lives in the code. So you can see the history of you changing your CI scripts over time in Git. There's one complaint I commonly hear from people about GitHub Actions. I should have gotten a screenshot about it. But it's basically every single time when you're first setting up your GitHub Actions, you need to make a totally random nonsense commit to get it to run again. And so you have this long history of trying to fix GitHub Actions, trying to fix GitHub Actions 2, trying to fix GitHub Actions 3. But while I was writing this blog post that was originally about how to use GitHub Actions sort of like a cron job where you're scheduling it, I discovered that there is a thing, and you can go to this blog post, which will be in that QR code to share at the end, where you actually have a new button in your GitHub Actions that just runs it. And you can run it as many times as you want without pushing up a new commit. And it's magic and brilliant, and I don't know why they don't publicize it more. All right, you should have a staging site. You want your website to be available on the public internet 24 hours a day, not just when you're sharing it on ngrok or expose or something like that. Ngrok and expose are great because they allow you to share that while you're working on a specific branch. But your clients should always have access to work on this when it's not just you having to go in and share it for them. So we always want to set up a staging site that is as close to production configuration as possible. You want to use the same deploy scripts. You want to have your SSL and HSTS setups the same. And you basically just want everything other than maybe like how big is the server to be the same. Same version of Ubuntu, same version of NPM, same version of PHP. Because if something's going to break on prod, it should break on staging first. Okay? So if there's anything other than how big is the server or something like that that is going to make a difference there, you want to get those in line with each other. Yet another thing that seems small, but then you get to the point where the client needs it, and you're like, oh, it's going to take a little while to set that up, and I wish we had. You should just do it at the beginning of every project, set up a mail server. You don't have to set up a real mail server, though. One of the problems people have is, oh, we have all the seeded data, and we don't want to accidentally run something that sends 10,000 emails to bob@example.com. Well, you can use a fake emailer as well. So if you're going to use a real emailer, we personally prefer Postmark because they have the best deliverability. They didn't pay me to say this. We just have tested all of them, and that's our favorite. But if you want a fake mailer, there's a lot of great options. You can use Hello by Beyond Code, which is a GUI app that you pay for. You can use MailPit, which you can install with things like Homebrew or Docker, and it's free. Or you can pay a little bit of money for a SaaS. And obviously, I usually like the free thing, but this SaaS is brilliant. First of all, just like the others, you get this fake email inbox, and every single email you send from your app ends up in this email inbox. But you can also have a different inbox for every single project you're working on, and you can invite your PMs and your developers and your clients just to that inbox. So you can say, hey, client, we're working on this email. You don't have to send it to your logs and send them screenshots and be actively involved when they're testing it. They can just log into their account with Mailtrap, and they can do their password resets there, or they can do their authentication there, or they can see what this particular broadcast email looks like there, and you're not involved at all. It's just automatically there, and it's really brilliant for clients testing staging sites. All right, we talked about this earlier, but you also want to be managing your bugs. So there's a few main players in the bug space. Bugsnag was the earliest one that was super involved in Laravel 10, 15 years ago. You've probably heard of Sentry today. Sentry sponsors a lot of things, and they have an integration with Forge. And then we also have Flare, which is created by some folks within the community. All of these do effectively the same thing. When an exception happens, it pushes that exception up to the service, and you get notified in Slack. If you don't have it that way, definitely set it up so everyone can see it in one place. You can have conversations about it. You can see a full stack trace. You can see context. You can see who triggered this issue. You can assign it to somebody. You can close it. It's really brilliant, especially when you're in a staging site where you're not just seeing a full stack trace in front of you or where your client is testing it and they're like, I just see a whole bunch of gobbledygook code. You can be like, yeah, that's fine. We already got it notified in our Slack and that's it. That's a pretty easy go-to, but you've got logs here with a question mark. In theory, if we sent all of our server logs up to something like PaperTrail, we could make it so that every time we run into a bug, we can say, not only do I know all the wonderful things that these bug providers handle for us, but we can also correlate it together with the logs that were happening at the same time. And this is a really great idea that, like, in theory, we could do that, and we can see which lines in the bug, you know, entry are connected to which lines in the log, and we can correlate them. In practice, it's really difficult to do. So if you're doing it, good on you. Maybe you should give a talk next year and teach me. But in general, I found that while it is a nice idea to send all your logs and manage them, usually it's only people who have dedicated ops and DevOps teams that are actually doing this. So again, I'm not saying don't do it, but I'm saying don't feel pressure if you're not doing it. You should do bugs. Logs is a nice to have, okay? Process and practices. So one of the most important things with process, I don't know what you're laughing at. I don't know what's going on here. You want to pick a productivity ideology, and sometimes folks don't like the word ideology because it has certain meanings around, you know, like how you think about the world. So let's just step it down. At any point, anybody in the team should be able to answer this question very clearly, very easily, with minimal effort. Okay? And you've got to figure out what that looks like, but I can tell you right now it's not Jira. What you want is the simplest possible solution for task management, for assignment definition. And the thing is, a lot of people say, well, I look at this big company, and this big company is successful, and they do it this way, so therefore we should, like microservices, right? No, you shouldn't, because you're not Amazon. That's not actually what you need. What you need is what makes the most sense for the team that you have right now. And with technology, and also with product management, the vast majority of the time, it is the simplest possible thing, whether it's sticky notes or whatever else, that makes sure every single person knows what they should do, and that people who are changing what they should do have the ability to change that in an easy, clear way. That's what you're looking for. So at Titan, we use Kanban boards. We use a tool called Trello, but you can use Kanban powered by anybody else. And for us, The most important thing is a to-do, doing, done. They call it backlog. But a backlog just means to-do, right? And you can add more columns if you want. So for example, we almost always have a column called for review, whether it means the developers need to review it or the client needs to review it. There's almost always at least one of those. And sometimes you don't have one done list. You have a done list for every sprint or something like that. And maybe you have multiple backlogs. That's fine. In the end, we should know what's coming up next, what's happening, what's done. More importantly than anything else, and it should be as easy as possible to move things through there, to add comments, to assign people, to upload images, to connect to GitHub issues, whatever. So you might use GitHub projects, you might use Monday, you might use something else, but you want to simplify the task management process, because just like bike shedding, we should not spend half an hour trying to figure out what to do next. We should look at a list, take the item off the list, move it into doing, work on it. That's it. One process you want to think about is Git branching. You will be unsurprised to hear I say you should use the simplest possible solution. Git flow is very popular. You should also, if at all possible, do something called continuous deployment. Continuous integration means every single time you do certain things in code, a script runs. Continuous deployment says one of those scripts is actually pushing your code to a server. Now, doing continuous deployment for your production site can be kind of scary, but at least set up continuous deployment for staging. It's the first step to get there, okay? So you want to pick some kind of Git branching strategy that allows you to do that, at least for your staging server. Git flow is popular. We're not going to walk through it because I think it's a little bit too complex. At Titan, we have a simplified version that I would definitely recommend you consider, which I very fancily call Git flow-ish. It's not quite GitHub flow, if you're asking. But essentially, your code lives on main, and everything on main goes to production. And then your code always at least has a develop branch. Everything on develop goes to your staging environment. Those two are always there. If you want to do some work, you do a, wait, hold on, I have a thingy. Look at this. You do a feature branch. And you pull off your feature branch and you start working on it, or you pull off your feature branch and you finish. When you're done with the feature branch, you merge it back to develop, which means it's automatically deployed to staging. And when it's ready, and at any point, develop should be able to merge to main. You should never have develop in a state where it can't be merged to main. So when you're ready, you merge develop up to main. It's good to go. And that means it's pushed to production. Occasionally, some things are so wrong and you can't go through our normal development workflow that you need to just do a commit directly off to main. So you hotfix it and you merge to main and you merge to develop, and both of them are in sync and both of them are ready to deploy. But in general, it's basically just like main is as prod, develop is staging, feature branches merge back into develop, develop merge back into main, good to go. So that's the end of our three big sections, but I want to talk a little about once you have finished those, what do we do next? This is not an announcement. I'm just saying, when my friends let me know that they are expecting a baby, the first thing I tell them is everybody around you is going to tell you what worked for them and what they did and how you're supposed to do it because they did it this way and their baby slept. They did it this way and their baby didn't have any trouble in school or whatever else it ends up being. And the advice I give them is nobody knows you, nobody knows your partner, nobody knows your baby, nobody knows your family, nobody knows your exact environment better than you do. But everyone thinks they know because what worked for them obviously is going to work for you, but that's not reality. That's not actually what it's like. So in this environment, in this analogy, your app is your baby. And that doesn't mean you shouldn't try to learn from other people. But just like with child rearing advice, my best and favorite programming advice is those that recognizes that you are in a unique context. The people on your team, the constraints that you're under, the environment you're working in, the code you have, the timelines you have, the deadlines, nobody understands it better than you. And so the best advice you can possibly get is advice that focuses on people over processes. And if you've ever seen this hideous, god-awful, ugly website before, you're familiar with the Agile Manifesto, which is very different than the Agile Industrial Complex that tells you, you must have sprints and Scrum Masters, you're not doing it right. Screw all of that. But this is all about figuring out what works for you and your people. So more important than anything else, more important than anything else I said, you can ignore all the other things I said as long as you recognize that what matters the most is figuring out what works for your people, your context, your applications, your needs, your stakeholders, whatever else. And if you do that, you're going to be fine. Here's the QR code. If you scan this, it's going to give you a gist. It does not currently have a link to these notes. But once I upload these to SpeakerDeck later, I should have taken a picture of you guys all doing this. This is so fun. Once I upload them to SpeakerDeck later, I will upload this gist, and so it'll have the link to the notes as well. And that's it. Thank you all so much.